Hello students, good afternoon to all of you. I hope you will be fine at home. So I welcome you in the series of this lecture, that is of unit number 4, and the subject name is Power System Instrumentation, and code number is EE311 as per our SUV curriculum. And the topic which we are covered, it is in the Power System Instrumentation, and subtopic is Measurement of Active Power and Reactive Power in Power Plants. Now, one thing I want to tell you, my dear student, that is the power system instrumentation. So if I'm talking about the power system instrumentation, though power system instrumentation is basically the important subject in the power system. Because if I'm talking about the electrical engineering, so in electrical engineering, the two subjects are very important and main, on which we can say the pillars of electrical engineering branch. One is the electrical machines, another one is the power system. And electrical machines are basically divided into two categories, one and two. In one machine, we can say that it is deals with the direct current machines, rotating and non-rotating. Rotating means motor and generator, DC motor and DC generator. And non-rotating, it is a transformer, but it is based on AC. So if I'm talking about the second part, is totally deals with the AC machines. We having the synchronous motor and asynchronous machine. We can say asynchronous and synchronous. Asynchronous known as induction. It is widely used in a system and we are using it. So I hope you understand because you have studied in the third and fourth semester, but you are right now you are in the fifth sem, so you know all about this thing. Second, we having the power system, but power system starts from the fifth sem, we can say. Why is it so? Because first the power system we can say start from the second year also, because in second year we have the PGP and GEP subject, the generation of electrical power and the power generation process. So if I'm talking about the generation of electrical power, so how can we generate electrical power? The first thing is there, as per the energy conservation law, then energy neither be created nor be destroyed, but we can transform it from one form to the another. If I'm transforming it from one form to the another, it means we can convert into one form to another, electrical to mechanical, mechanical to electrical, though we are converting this thing, we are doing this. So similar to that, we having in generation of electrical power, how we generate. So first generation we can see like the thermal power plant. So in thermal power plant, what we do? We basically heat up the water, convert into the steam. That steam having the kinetic energy, and we flow it from the nozzle, basically from the valve. It basically expands at the nozzle of the turbine that rotate. Means kinetic energy is converted into the mechanical energy, and we can correct the electrical machine second part equipment, that is alternator, a synchronous generator. So we connect that one, and through this we can convert into the electrical power. Similar to that, in if I'm talking about the nuclear power plant, in thermal power plant we use coal fired thermal plant. Nuclear is also a thermal plant because we are working on steam or heat, but in nuclear power plant we use nuclear fission technology, uranium-238 or plutonium we can use. By the heat of that, we heat up the water and basically perform the same operation similar to that thermal power station. In gas, we can also do this. Okay, in petroleum, we can also do this. But in hydropower plant, we do what? We basically the energy of water, flowing water, that is 1 upon 2 mv square, where we have the mass and velocity. But in this hydropower plant, we having 1 upon 2 mh square. M is basically the mass, but h is the hydropower energy. So in this, what we do, we having stored the water in the reservoir, then we having the penstoke. That penstoke is basically the water pressure. That water pressure is the 1 upon 2 mv square. That rotate the winding, basically rotate the turbine. That turbine is attached with the alternator, again machine part, to convert into the electrical energy. These are the, we can say, conventional energy source. But if I am talking about the non-conventional, then it will be solar, wind and all these. So they are the generation. They generate at the 11 kV and whatever the desired level we can say. And this step up transfer we are using, that is a part of machine one. Okay. Then transfer step up, then we step down up to the first step up to 765, then 400, 220, 132, we can say 33 and 11. So transmission parts are up to 132 and 33 and 11 are comes in the domestic part. From where we getting the domestic the supply, that is of 240 volt or 4154. 240 in single phase, phase to neutral, and 415 volt is the phase to phase, that is three phase. that is the generation. Then we having the transmission, how distribution, power system engineering, power system analysis. So many things we are going to study, or some part we have studied in our earlier classes. So the power system instrumentation is the important part of it. Why it is important part of it? Because in this we are going to study, or we have studied a lot about the instruments which is used for the measuring in power system. In what? In power system. So which type of instrument we are using for the measurement of power, energy, voltage, current in power system, that deals with. So the first unit which we have studied is basically the RF, because if we having so many instruments which is using for the measuring purpose, but that measuring purpose is basically do what? For example, if I'm talking about the electrical measuring instrument, so in electrical measuring instruments, EMI, we have understood about the PMMC working, MI working, induction type working, instrument transformers, potentiometer, so many things we have understood. But in this, it is advanced version. So in this, the first is the errors. So if I'm using an instrument, so many errors are taking place, because if I'm a human being, so there are some mistakes. I do the mistakes, or some blunders I do, because I am a human being. You can also, you are doing, and you will do, you may be do, because you are the human being. So these are known as the errors, and errors present in the instrument. How it is present in the instrument? Basically, errors are of different types, such as random error, gross error, instrumental error, systematic error, all these, environmental error, parallax error, vision error. Okay, we can say we are not correcting, cannot calibrating it, not taking the reading in the measurement form. So these are the errors. So in this error, we having two things: accuracy and precision. Accuracy, the word came from accurate. Accurate means true value. Means the reading is 4 volt. The reading will be the 4 volt, but you are getting the reading 3.8, 3.6, 3.7, 3.5, 3.9, 3.7, 3.8, but not 4. So that is the precision. Repetitive readings. So precision is there and accuracy is there. And if I want to calculate the errors, so different methods we have. We can place errors on the Gaussian curve. In the positive or negative values, we can make a curve of it, that is Gaussian curve. So through this Gaussian curve, we can basically calculate the errors. So how can we measure the errors? If we having different values, then first take a mean. First take what? First take a mean of it. And if I am taking the mean of it, then after the mean, we can take the deviation. Deviation means, for example, the mean reading, I having the 8 readings. Okay, the mean reading I am getting, that is 4.7. But the deviation is 4.5 to 4.7, 2 deviations. 4.6 to 4.7, again 1. 4.8 to 1.7, minus 1. 4.9 to 4.7, again we can say minus 2. So plus and minus we having, we can make a curve of it, that is the average deviation, and we found the deviations. So by subtracting, we get this deviation, and we can calculate it, that is average deviation, standard deviation, statistical theory we have studied. Then we can also find the variance. Okay, so these all we have studied in the unit number 1. Now in unit number 2, basically it is a very important unit. Why it is a very important unit, my dear student? Because if I am measuring something, measuring means I want to convert the physical quantity into the electrical quantity. The physical quantity may be the, we can say, mechanical, acoustic, chemical, we can say pressure, temperature, displacement. Okay. So many things are there. Temperature is also there. So if you want to convert that thing into the another form of energy, that may be the electrical, because we are an electrical student, so we can talk for it. So that electrical energy conversion is basically with the help of an instrument or a device or element or a particle of the system, that is transducer. That is what? Transducer. And transducer is a component, is an element which is used to transform one form of energy to the another. Generally we converting one form, that is physical quantity, into the electrical form, that is our requirement, our need, our demand. Now one thing is there, in this transducer we need two things. One is the sensing element, that is sensor. Another one is the transduction element.
if I am talking about the transaction element, so in transaction we having different basis on the transaction we can divide into. For example, we having inductive, capacitive, displacement, linear displacement, photoconductive, phototransductive, photovoltaic. Okay, so piezoelectric is there. So digital, analog, primary, secondary, so many things. We having so many characteristics: sensitiveness, accuracy, efficiency. Okay, effectiveness. So all these are come in the characteristic. Though we have understood these all things in the unit number two, then we having different transducer for the measurement, like LVDT, linear variable differential transformer transducer, RVDT, rotatory, can say variable distance transducer. Then we having the strain gauges, thermistor, thermocouple. Okay, RTD, resistance temperature detector, potentiometer pot. We have understood so many things. The Hall effect for the magnetic measurement. So for all the measurements, we have a different transducers that convert the simple thing. Piezoelectric crystal is there. It is a very basic example. If we apply force on piezoelectric crystal, that it convert into the voltage. And if we are applying voltage on it, that it convert the displacement, change of it. So we can say the both cases. In the both cases, conversion from one form to another, another form to one form. And this is the electrical transducer, so we can say the transducer. But inverse transducer is also there. Directly we can converting electrical to another magnetic form. That is, if I am applying the the voltage on the piezoelectric crystal, it changes its dimension, means displacement. So we have studied a lot about the transducer in the unit number two. Now in the unit number three, we have studied about the signal conditioning. Now what is signal conditioning? Signal conditioning is basically how can we condition the signal. Means how can we filter out, how can we remove the unwanted signal from the that signal. So first I have to sense it, then I have to do it. So I need a transducer. So for signal conditioning, we need a transducer. Why we need a transducer? Because we want to convert, for example, I want to convert magnetical into the electrical. Do I need a transducer? Okay. And in this, all this conditioning, we need the amplification. So in amplification, we having the instrumentation amplifier. So instrumentation amplifier is what? Is basically the combination of op-amps. Op-amp is the operational amplifier. And operational amplifier, which we are using, is basically the IC74WIN chip of 8 pins, in which 5 pins are in the use, 3 pins are not in the use, one for the null set, two for the no connections, and out of 5, 2 are for the inputs, one is inverting, another one is the non-inverting, 2 are the positive voltage and negative voltage, and 1 is for the output. So I hope you understand this thing. So we can do with the help of this in basically the unit number 3. But in this first amplifier is the instrumentation amplifier. So instrumentation amplifier, we use 3 op-amps, okay, and then take the output. Then we have in the isolation amplifier. Isolation is used for the isolation purpose. And why it is used for the isolation? For preventing the leakage current. It does not flow in the patient body. If I am applying some instrument, if I am connecting some instrument to the body of the patient, because if I want to measure the something pulse rate and all these things, oxygen level nowadays, and temperature, MRI I want to do. So if I want to do this all, do I have to connect some points on the patient body? So if I have no isolation amplifier, though I can't able to protect the body from the electrical shock or leakage current. Okay, so I hope you understand. Then we having the analog multiplier and divider, in which we can divide or multiply with the help of Gilbert mixer. We having the local oscillator there. That local oscillator generate the local frequency, and by the multiplication frequency we can increase the frequency value. How we can increase the frequency value? In which manner? For example, in the input I am getting 4 hertz, and I am multiplying it with the 100 hertz, so I am getting 400 hertz at the output. And in the Gilbert mixer we do this thing. So we can divide it, we can multiply it. So analog divider and analog multiplier. Okay, adder and subtractor we have also. Then we having the basically optocoupler. Okay, we having the optical amplifier, that is optocoupler. We having the magnetic isolation is there, that we use the transformer for the isolation purpose. Function generator is there. In the function generator we can generate a function. It's just like the oscillator also. In function generator, we having what? We can generate the waveforms of different shape, different size, different amplitude, different frequency. For example, I have to generate a frequency of 50 hertz, triangular wave, so I can do it. Rectangular wave, I can do it. Sinusoidal sine wave, I can do it with the help of function generator. So function generator is also necessary. So we have understand this function generator in the unit number 3. Okay, then we having the frequency to voltage converter. We use FVC in a short form. So frequency voltage converter, again we are using integrator, that is op-amp. In function generator, again we are using op-amp. In basically the, you can say, which I am talking about, that is frequency to voltage converter. Again, I am using what? I am converting the input Vm sin omega t, we can say the input frequency of the wave, into the voltage. It is corresponding to that. So I need what? I need two things, the voltage calibration and the frequency filters. So two path in the FVC we can have. So frequency to voltage converter, then we having, we can say, temperature to voltage converter. So it is similar to that, we can use it, but we use integrator, means op-amp, operational amplifier, because operational amplifier is IC741, and with the help of operational amplifier we can convert to so many things, because it's having the higher gain. So we can use the op-amp in so many applications. For example, voltage multiplier, multiplication, addition, subtraction, differentiation, integration, logarithmic, anti-logarithmic, adding. So all the mathematical operation we can perform with the help of op-amp, that is operational amplifier. Okay, then we understand about the two three main things. One is the grounding, another one is the shielding. So in the grounding, we can ground by the two ways. Single point grounding, in this single point grounding, what we do, connect all the instruments leakage part or the grounding part to a one point, that is single point. In a multi point, if I am in the 8 instrument or 9 instrument, so I have to connect 9 individual grounding, so that is multiple point. Why I am doing the grounding? Because safety, electrical safety we want. If leakage current will be there due to fault, so that leakage current will flow that path where the low impedance is there. So in grounding, we make the path of that leakage current of low impedance. If higher impedance is there, no leakage current will flow, because if you are a person, though, you always flow that path in which you have minimum hurdles, low light controls, minimum circuit, you can say speed breakers. So that is the thing. Okay, I hope you understand. Then we understand about the shielding. So shielding is also very important. We want to shield it from the external disturbances. So the windings is also available with the shield, or cables, copper graded cables are there with the shielding pack. So we have understood all this. Then in unit number 4, which we have started earlier, in unit number 4 is basically the measurement part. How can we measure the voltage and current? So in voltage, measurement of voltage and current, we use voltmeter and ammeter. And one instrument is that is the multimeter. Through multimeter, we can measure the voltage, current, DC voltage, AC voltage, DC current, AC current. Okay, basically in a single machine, in a single meter. And we can also identify the doping level of semiconductor devices. Okay, and impedance we can also find. So if I am talking about the voltmeter and ammeter, it is an individual instrument. So PMMC, I am using it, it having the limitation that we can use only for the DC measurement. If I am using moving iron, that is attraction of the repulsion type, then we can measure for the AC current. So these are the limitations. And we always connect across the terminals, that is voltmeter. And in the terminals, between the terminals, that is series, means ammeter. So ammeter always connect in a series manner, and voltmeter is always connect in a parallel manner, shunt manner. So series manner is there and parallel manner is there. So I hope you understand. So voltmeter, we have understood about two types, digital or analog. The ammeter is again digital analog, giving the loading effect also. Okay, so we can do this. So if loading effect, basically the internal resistance varies the reading also, because in a current, in a meter, we having the internal resistance. In a voltmeter, we having the internal resistance. So while we are measuring something with the help of these two instruments, though these two instruments effect produce an effect, that is loading effect by its internal resistance. So I hope you understand. Then we having this whole thing. Then after before this, for this topic, we have understand one thing more. That is the voltage. That is a measurement of frequency and phase. So with the help of CRO, that is cathode ray oscilloscope. The main thing is the CRT. In CRT, we have horizontal and vertical plates, electron gun, and focusing and aligning the anode and cathode. That basically due to Lissajous figure, we can obtain the calculate the frequencies with the deflection. We can calculate the measure the voltage, frequency, and phase angles. So we have understand this thing whole. Now in this lecture, what we are going to study is the measurement of active power and reactive power in power plants. Now one thing I want to told you, tell you basically, the active and reactive power are basically the comes in the complex power. So in complex power, we have two powers, that is three powers. First is the apparent, then we have the active, and we have the reactive power. So in a simple way, what I want to say you, that active power is basically the power which is based in the resistor, that is I square R, okay? And the reactive power which is consumed by the capacitor or the reactor. Because if I am talking about the inductor, my dear student, the inductor always consumes the current and convert into the magnetostatic energy. Magnetic field always give you the flux. Why it is giving you the flux? Because it's having the turns. So phi is proportional to I, phi is equals to li, l representing the inductance or inductor of that coil, means turns. Okay, and if I'm talking about the capacitor, the capacitor always store in the form of electrostatic field, that is charges, that are the charges. I hope you understand. So these we are going to study. Now what are my objectives? If I am delivering this lecture, so there will be some objective from my side. The help the learner means you student to understand the basics of active power and reactive power. What is active, what is reactive, and understand the detailed theory about the measurement of active power and reactive power in power plants. So moving forward, apparent power and power factor. The average power depends upon the RMS value of voltage and current and the phase angle between them. So we can say, if I am talking about the average power. So average power depends upon the RMS, that is effective value, we can say effective power. So RMS value of the voltage and current and the phase angle between them. So here it is written 1 upon 2 Vm, that is maximum voltage, Im, that is maximum current, cos is the angle, theta V minus theta I. Okay, so we can also write like Vrms, Irms, because 1 upon 2 is there, we can convert into the RMS value. So Vrms, Irms, cos theta V minus theta I. The apparent power is the product of the RMS value of the voltage and current. It is measured in volt amperes, VA, apparent power. We can say the phase sum of active and reactive power. Active and reactive power. So we can write here that S is equals to 1 upon 2 VmIm is equals to VrmsIrms. IRMs. Okay, now volt ampere. It is always found in a volt ampere. And if I'm talking what, it is the active power. If VAR, that is the reactive power. So the power factor is the cosine of the phase difference between voltage and current, that is cosine angle, and we can say it is a ratio of resistance to the impedance. So it is also cosine of the angle of the load impedance. The power factor maybe is regarded as the ratio of the real power dissipated to the apparent power of the load, means active to the apparent power. We can say also this, that power factor is basically the ratio of resistance to the impedance in a circuit, and we can also say that it is a ratio of, we can say the active power to the apparent power. It is given here, P by S, R by Z. So it has become cos theta V minus cos theta I. And we can say cos theta V minus theta I. Now P is the apparent power into power factor, that is S is equals to P. S is the apparent power we are seeing, and power factor is PF. So S into PF, we can say, we are taking the relation because it is a ratio of active to the apparent power. So we can say active power is what? We can represent like this. Active to the apparent power. So apparent active power is what? Apparent power into power factor. You can see. Okay. I hope you understand. Now, apparent power and the power factor. Not all the apparent power is consumed if circuit is partially reactive. All power is not consumed. Not all the power, apparent power is consumed if the circuit is partially reactive. Means, now purely resistive, we can say load R, then we can say theta V minus theta is always 0. Always we are getting the power factor 1. You can say Im sin omega t, so omega t is 0, because R is there, no phase difference between voltage and I, so we are getting the power factor unit. P by S will also one, all power are consumed. All power are consumed. Purely reactive load L or C, so theta V minus theta is will be the plus minus 90 degree, so PF will become zero here. If real, purely reactive we can say. Impure we can say, practically it is not possible, though P is zero, no real power consumption. No real power consumption we can say. Resistive and reactive load, though R and L by C, so we can say theta V minus theta is always better than zero. Theta V minus theta is or less than zero. Lagging, inductive load. We represent lagging means current is lagging. Basically, if current is the variable factor in the measuring thing, so if current is lagging means that is inductive, and current is leading means capacitive. Because the inductor I am using in a AC supply, so if in that case the current lag by the angle of 90 degree with respect to voltage, so that is lagging. And if I am talking with the capacitive, so in capacitive the current is lead by the angle of 90 degree with respect to voltage, so that is the capacitive, or we can say the capacitor effect we have. Now here it is looking like this. P by S is less than 1, part of the apparent power is consumed, part of the apparent. Now inductive circuit and reactive power, so we can say here what we can find here. Now see the power delivered to the element by the source. So first case, in the positive, energy absorbed, energy retained. Now if an inductor is there, so if I am giving the AC supply, so in the cycle it absorbed, and in the remaining cycle if I am not giving, so it is returned. So baking a loop, consuming and giving, absorbing and returning, it look like this, it is baked. So Vm sin omega t plus theta, so it is equals to Im sin omega t. Now here voltage is leading, so we are using plus sign, plus theta. If voltage is lagging, then I use minus theta. So P of t is Vt into it, so we are getting 1 upon 2 Vm Im cos theta, 1 upon 2 cos 2 omega t plus 1 upon 2 Vm Im sin theta. Sin 2 omega t means sin A sin B formula is there. And V RMS I RMS we can say cos theta 1 minus cos 2 omega t plus V RMS RMS I RMS sin theta sin 2 omega t. So Vm Im sin 2 omega t, theta is equals to 90, is purely inductive. If it is purely inductive, so PT is equally both positive and negative power is circulating. PT is equally both positive and negative power is circulating, we can see. Now capacitive circuit and reactive power. Now in capacitive circuit, it is, if it start from negative, because in this it returned, first is return, basically charging and discharging of the capacitor. How it works? It works with the help of charging and discharging of capacitor. So first you start from the discharging, so it is return, then it absorbed, then return, absorbed, return. So it start from the negative side, it start from the negative side. So capacitive circuit and the reactive power. So Vt is equals to Vm sin omega t plus theta, It is equals to Im sin omega t. Now Pt is equals to, like this, we are getting again same thing. Here we are having the same thing. Now theta has become minus 90 degree. Why I am writing minus 90 degree, my dear student? Because in capacitor, the voltage lags by the current with the angle of 90 degree. So it is lagging by the angle of current of 90 degree. That is why I am using theta is equals to minus 90 degree for capacitor. Okay, I hope you understand. Now P of t is equally both positive and negative power is circulating. Complex power. Now if I am talking about the complex power, though the complex power contains all the information pertaining to the power absorbed by a given load. Pertaining to the, we can say the power absorbed by a given load. Now complex power always given by S equals to P plus jQ. You can write 1 upon 2 VI. And V RMS, I RMS, theta V minus theta. Theta V is for the voltage and theta is for the current. We can say. So apparent power is always like this. VRMS IRMS is equals to root P square plus Q square. We can make it with the help of power triangle. We can make it. We can also drive this thing with the help of the power triangles. So real power is basically P is equals to RE, that is due to the resistance of S, that is S cos theta V minus theta I. And reactive power is basically Im, I'm representing here. So that is the due to the current, which is basically absorbed or consumed by the reactance or capacitance, means inductor or capacitor. Now power factor we can say P by S, that is cos
theta V minus theta E. So real power is the actual power dissipated by the load, as I earlier told you, because active power is the power which is dissipated in a resistance, in a resistor. Because if I am talking about the resistor, so resistor always wastes the power. The dissipation we find in the form of heat in a resistance I square R. Okay. Now the reactive power is a measure of the energy exchange between source and reactive power absorbed. Now reactive power is the measure of the energy exchange between source and reactive power part of the load. Now these are the power triangles. These are what? These are the power triangles. Now, though we can say the power triangle is complex power is represented by the power triangle, similar to the impedance triangle. Power triangle has four items: P, Q, S, and theta. Basically, it's having three items, but theta is the another item which gives you the phase difference between the thing. So we can say the power triangle is representing here. This S is representing the apparent power, P is representing the active power, Q is representing the reactive power. So S is equals to P plus JQ, and we can also say that S is equals to root P square plus Q square, or we can apply the Pythagoras theorem here. In Pythagoras, the hypotenuse square is equals to perpendicular square plus B square. So hypotenuse is the S, that is apparent power, and the base is basically the active power, and Q is the reactive power, that is your perpendicular. So we can say S square is equals to P square plus Q square. So one thing I want to tell you here, my dear student, that the triangle I am making with the help of angular displacement. Now apparent power is the complex sum of, or the phasor sum of, active and reactive power. Active power which is dissipated in the form of heat in our circuit, that is due to by the resistance. So the resistance wasted the power is known as this one, active power. And the power which is consumed in the whole cycle, in a whole cycle, we can say, by the inductor and capacitor, that is known as reactive power. So that is the reactive power. If I am talking about the impedance triangle, though the baseline is always represented by the R, same phase, X is maybe the L or C, and Z is the impedance. And this is the whole diagram for the lagging or leading. If I am talking about the leading, it means the voltage is like lagging but current is leading. If I am talking about the lagging, the voltage is leading but current is lagging. So this, the whole the upper portion is showing you the inductor portion, and the lower portion is showing for the capacitor. So that is the thing. Theta is equals to zero, resistive load, unity power factor, all these. Okay. Now theta is less than zero, capacitive load, leading power factor, negative side. And theta is greater than zero, that is inductive load, and we can also say that it is a lagging PF, that is lagging power factor. So I hope you understand. Now see here, it is a power triangle, and how can we calculate the whole thing in this? Finding a total complex power of three loads. First load is 0 watt, 100 watt. Another load is load number 2, 300 watt, that is reactive power, and 200 watt, that is active power. 1500 watt. Reactive power and 300 watt is the active power. So how can we do it? That is resistance, because VAR is zero. That is inductance, that is capacitance. So PT is equals to 100 plus 200 plus 300, that is 600 watt. Total we are getting what? 100 plus 200 plus 300, 600 watt. Now QT, that is reactive power. So in this we are having zero. In this we are having 700 watt. In this we are having the 1500 watt. VAR means reactive power. Unit of reactive power is watt, and the unit of active power is watt, and unit of apparent power is VA. So ST, if I am talking about the ST, that is 600 minus J 800, that is 1000. If we represent the rectangle quantity in the polar form, and we are getting the angle, that is minus 53.13 angle, because if I am doing so, so we are getting minus 800, and here we are getting 600. That is the real power, or we can say the real quantity, and that is the imaginary, we can say the imaginary quantity. So real and imaginary. So we are getting the power in the form of this one. 1000 we are getting of the S, QT we are getting 800, and PT, as per the our power triangle, the PT we are getting 600 watt. So we can make, or we can make the, how can we find this VAR, active and reactive? This is the basic example. Then in a power system, we having these three loads are connected, so we can measure it in a simple through this. So I hope you understand. Now moving forward, Now calculate the power factor seen by the source and the average power supplied by the source. So here the RMS voltage is given in the form of AC, that is 40 angle of 0 degree. We have in the 10 ohm resistance, we have in the 8 ohm resistance, capacitor is of the capacitance we can say minus J 6 ohm and plus J 4 ohm. So inductor value is not given and capacitor value is not given, but the impedance of this resistor or in capacitor is given. So we can say the total impedance as seen by the sources 10 plus J 4 in series and parallel to 8 minus J 6 we can say. So we are getting 10 plus J 4 8 minus J 6 upon 8 minus J 2. So Z is equal to 12.69 angle of 20.62. That is, we are converting from rectangle quantity to the polar quantity, polar form, complex quantity we can say. Now the power factor is P cos, the angle is given, that is 20.62. So 0.936 lagging because inductive load is higher. IRMS is VRMS by Z, that is 40 by Z is given to you, that is 30.152, angle is minus 20.62. Now minus sign showing you the lagging, leading basically. Lagging showing you the upper. Now here it is showing you the this thing, it shows the lagging. Minus I am getting. Now average power supplied by the source is equal to the power absorbed by the load. So P is equals to IRMS square R. So IRMS we are getting here, and R we have already know, the total resistance we have, so we are getting 118 watt. So P is equals to VRMS IRMS power factor, so V into this one, so whole we are getting 118 watt, near to 118. So I hope you understand. This is the basic numerical which we solve to understand or identify the average power supplied by the source and power factor. So I hope you understand. Now the power equipment are related using their apparent power in kV. So basically it is a transformer showing here. This is the radiator fins, this is the we can say bushings we having where we connect the supply of high voltage and low voltage, and this is the tank in which the transformer is placed with the oil, that is transformer oil. So this is the power equipment are related using their apparent power in kV, kilovolt ampere. Apparent power and power factor we can say both have same P apparent powers, and PFs are different generator of the second load is overloaded. Now see here, 600 volt is given, 120 kilowatt is the power, current is given to you, this is the resistive load. Which load? Resistive. So P will always be 120 kilowatt and Q is 0 because no reactance and no capacitance is there. So we can't say the reactive power, or we can say the reactive power is 0 here. Why it is zero? Because no inductive and capacitive load is connected. So the S total power will become 120 because P plus JQ, P is given here, but Q is become zero here. Now 600 volt is given here. Current is flowing 353 ampere. We are getting the blast like this because current is heavy. Now here we have the parallel connection. Inductor connected parallel to the resistor. So we can say the QL will be the 100 watt, that is 100 kVAr. 160 kVAr I am getting, and 120 kilowatt is the active power. So we can find the total apparent power, that is P square plus Q square. So see here, generator is overloaded and we are getting 200 kV. So what we are getting, generator is overloaded. That is why the spark is producing. That showing you the overloading thing. Why it is showing you the overloading thing? Because the spark is producing. Okay, now the figure illustrating why electrical apparatus is rated in VA, that is apparent power. Instead of watts, both loads dissipate 120 kilowatt, but the current rating of the generator is exceeded because of the power factor of its load. So I am in the power factor, though due to this, we having two components, voltage and current and their angle. So by the help of voltage, by the help of current, we use the, we can say the voltage rating or unit, that is volt, and current rating is ampere. So volt ampere is basically the rating. I hope you understand. Now, apparent power and power factor. So overloading of the generators of the second load is avoided by applying power factor correction. We can do what? We can apply the power factor correction here. So for the circuit of figure 17 to 18B, we can say a capacitance with the QC 160 kVAr is added in parallel with the load, as in figure 17 to 19A, determine generator current I. जनरेटर करंट आईपी. सो पावर फैक्टर करेक्टेड लोड. नाउ द प्रीवियस बेसिकली व्हाट हैपेंड, द जनरेटर इज ओवरलोडेड. सो इफ आई वांट टू रिमूव द ओवरलोडिंग ऑन इट, आई हैव टू डू द पावर फैक्टर करेक्शन. सो पावर फैक्टर करेक्शन बेसिक मैथड. इफ वी हैव इन द लैगिंग पावर फैक्टर, नाउ आई वांट टू लीड इट, दो आई नीड कैपेसिटर. दो आई नीड व्हाट, आई हैव टू कनेक्ट द कैपेसिटर. कैपेसिटर डू व्हाट, बेसिकली इन कैपेसिटर द करंट लीड्स एंड वोल्टेज लैग्स. And an inductor current lags, voltage leads. So lagging, leading like this. One is lagging, another one is leading. So we are getting the resultant one. So power factor improves or corrected. So here, what I am doing here, 600 volt is given. Capacitor QC is there. 120 kilowatt and 160 kVAr we are finding. So 60 kilowatt and 120 kVAr is 0 watt. So corrected load. We are getting like this. So let QC is equals to 160 kVAr. We are connecting and load connected to the unity power factor. The power factor correction, the parallel capacitor greatly reduce the source current. Do what? Greatly reduce the source current. Now QT is basically 160 kVAr. We have already found out. Minus 160 kVAr means I have corrected the QC with corresponding to QT. So they basically sum up or differentiate, and we are getting the subtraction rate is in the form of zero. Same value having means same minus same, we'll get the zero. So therefore ST is equals to 120 kilowatt plus j0, because 0 is here, p plus jq. So p is given, that is 120 kilowatt, but p is become 0. So what we can write, 120 kilowatt plus 0 kVAr. Thus the ST, that is yours, the apparent power, or we can say the complex power, is 120 kVA. And I is equals to 120 kVA by 600 volt, power upon voltage 200 ampere. Thus the generator is no longer overloaded. Why we are placing the capacitor? If I am placing the capacitor, then it become the overload, non-loaded, non-overloaded. But if I am not placing the capacitor, though we are finding the spark here, we having the fire exist here, fire take place here. So I hope you understand. Now, complex power, we can find out the complex power S contain all the information pertaining to the power absorbed by the given load, pertaining to the power absorbed by the given load. So S is equals to 1 upon 2 VI, and VRMS and IRMS, we have IRMS star. IRMS star, basically we have 1 upon 2 VI star. That is VRMS, IRMS star. So I square RMS Z, can say because by the impedance. So V square RMS by Z star. Here the voltage is applying and current is flowing in the load. So VRMS will become what? VRMS angle of theta voltage of it. IRMS is IRMS theta I, and S equals to VRMS IRMS theta V, the voltage angle, and theta is the current angle. So VRMS IRMS theta V minus theta I, voltage and current angle, plus J VRMS IRMS sine theta V minus theta I. So we can say, if I am converting into triangular form, we can say, though in the simple trigonometric form, though we can compare the A plus JB with the R cos theta plus J sin theta, though cos theta will represent the active and sin theta will represent the reactive, or we can see the real quantities representing by the cos theta and imaginary quantities representing by the sin theta. So here P plus JQ is equal to RE of S, JIM of S, real power plus reactive power. So real power is the active power, which is represented by the P, and Q is the reactive power. I hope you understand. Now real power is only useful power delivered to the load. That is active power. The reactive power represents the energy exchange between the source and reactive part of the load. It is being transferred back and forth between the load and source. The unit of Q is volt ampere reactive, VAR, as I earlier told you. So S is equals to P plus JQ, RE of S plus JIM of S, real power plus reactive power. So S is equals to I square RMS Z. So I RMS square R plus JX is equals to P plus JQ. So we can say P is equals to VRMS IRMS cos theta V minus theta I, and R is equals to R E of S I square RMS R, and Q is equals to VRMS IRMS sin theta V minus theta I, and is equals to IM of S I square RMS X. So this is about the complex power. I hope you understand. S equals to P plus GQ, where S is the apparent, P is the active, and Q is the reactive. So these all are the MCQs related with the topics. Now the reactive power equation PR is I effective square WL sin omega n square omega t plus phi, that is the true. Reactive powers is expressed in what? Volt ampere reactive, volt ampere, and no unit. So if I am talking about the reactive power, so second option, B option, is correct, because that is VA, volt ampere reactive. What? The expression of reactive power PR is cos theta or sin theta, we can say effective. So sin theta is there, but the C option is there, B effective, that is RMS. I effective, that is RMS value of current. RMS value of voltage is effective value of, means RMS value of voltage. Effective value of current means RMS value of the current sin theta. So option C is correct. A sinusoidal voltage V of sin omega t is applied to a series RL circuit. The current is given by this value, determine the apparent power, that is S power. So we can say current is given to you, though we can find V into I. So directly we can do it, though the option is C, 630. We'll get what? 630. Now the power factor is the ratio of power to the power. So we can say active power to the apparent power. So active power to the apparent power, we can say. So option is A. Average, we can also say the average to the apparent. The expression of true power is PA sin theta, PA cos theta, PA tan theta, PA tan theta. So cos theta is there. So option is B. The average power PAVG is expressed as PA sec theta, PA sin theta, PA cos theta, PA sin theta, cos theta. Again, active power is there. So PA cos theta. The equation of reactive power is PA sin theta. So option is C. Now, a sinusoidal voltage applied to this, I is given to you, though we can find the power factor. We can easily find the power factor. That is your V by I is there, angle we are getting. So through this angle, omega t minus 53, that is 53 is there. So we can say cos minus 53, we'll get the value, that is option C, 0.6. A sinusoidal voltage V is equal to applied to RL circuit, the current is given, determine the average power. That is, we can say VI cos theta. So that is the value, option number C, that is 375. I hope you understand. So these are the references. Good books are available in our university library, that is RKS AK Sahani, Dhanpatra & Sons, Rajesh Prasad Khanna, having the name Electrical and Electronics Management and Electrical Measurement and Measuring Instruments. A.S. Morisot is a very good book of international author. So Principles of Measurement and Instrumentation by Prentice. So I took some material from these books to deliver this lecture. So these are the having the good content. So you can just refer it. So thank you from my side for patience with me. I hope you understand about this lecture. This is about the measurement of power, active and reactive in the power plant. How can we measure it? So I took some numericals for the better understanding. So I hope you understand. So thank you for patience listening. Thank you, my dear.